So the question is, when a National Marine Sanctuary is established, what protections are put in place? Is it a keep out? Is it a avoid this site kind of place? The answer to that is the rules. We work with the public to figure out what those rules should be. For example, the fishing community was very concerned with Thunder Bay National Marine Sanctuary of whether or not we were going to ban recreational fishing. That ended up not being what happened up there. Fishing takes place inside that sanctuary the same way it takes place outside of it. Really what you're looking at establishing are management tools. So with like Hawaiian Islands Humpback Whale National Marine Sanctuary or Stellwagen Bank National Marine Sanctuary or some of the other sanctuaries on the West Coast, you might be looking to restrict shipping speeds to avoid whale strikes. It gives people on board the boat more time to respond. If a large marine mammal is in the water, they can slow down. Or just the sound that those engines create can be extremely disturbing to those animals. So we work with the shipping industry, create tools, sometimes an app. That might not come from our office. That might come from fisheries. Create that app. It might work with us to do that. But it's really just establishing management practices that make it a sustainable place. Occasionally, there is an area that might be set aside that's like, don't go in there. Usually these are really small, sort of benign areas that aren't going to really interfere with anyone's livelihood, where they're set aside for research, to just so that we have pieces of the ocean that are, you know, kept away from other outside influences. So to the contrary, there's actually a national Get Into Your Sanctuary Day where we promote all the many and various ways to get into the National Marine Sanctuaries. That might be surfing, it might be sailing, it might be fishing, charter fishing. We work with charter boat operators to hopefully for them to educate the public on what we do, and hopefully they have some sustainable business practice, and we're happy to promote them for behaving that way. So it's really a community-driven effort. We bring the best science to fore for them to understand what the nature of the environment is and what our science is telling us should be done there for the best type of protection, but it's done in such a way, you know, where that's a conversation. It's not just a, you know, government coming in and saying this is what it's going to be. And that's extremely important. And that's why people are asking us, you know, hey, can you put one here? Yeah. Say that again?
Once it becomes a sanctuary, you can't remove any artifacts, is that correct?
Typically, now a lot of those laws are dictated by the state. So in the state of Michigan, you can't disturb the bottomlands. That's a state of Michigan thing. And there are state laws that would protect artifacts on shipwrecks. I'm not exactly sure what all those laws are. Certainly within the sanctuary, if there's a piece of pottery that's 200 years old sitting on a shipwreck, we want you to leave it there. You can pick it up, you know, put it back. We don't want you to put it in your garage anymore. So that is one of the things that we want to do. The goal is more people are going to want to come and visit Alpena and utilize the resources within that community if the things that make that community special are maintained. That's sort of the idea. Sort of like a national park. You know, you go to ancient Indian ruins in Chaco Canyon, New Mexico. Don't tear apart the buildings and bring a brick home because you were there. You know, similar to that. Any other questions? Yes, sir. What's the deepest I've gone? About 130. Oh, I do. She doesn't want me to. Do I want to become a tech diver? I absolutely want to become a tech diver. It's not something the government wants me to do. They don't want anybody to do it because it's so high risk. They want you to kind of do it on your own. Establish a track record of safe technical diving, and then they kind of give you their blessing afterwards. But I have gone through NOAA's dive training program, which when I took it was in Panama City, Florida, right where the Navy Dive Center is.
Tech diving, your reference
to mixed gases? Yeah, mixed gas diving, you want to do that. They want to see a lot of history of doing that. But then these guys in Thunder Bay, they're all doing closed circuit rebreather diving now. But then you carry a whole closed circuit rebreather. So basically what that is in open circuit scuba, you got the regulator in your mouth, you breathe in the air, you exhale, and the bubbles go out. Closed circuit rebreather is a loop. So your air mixture is coming in one side of a hose, and then when you exhale, it gets sent out the other side, gets sent through a system where the CO2 is filtered out, and then based off of the depth that you're at, a certain amount of oxygen is then added to that mixture, or a diluent is added to that mixture, so that you maintain a partial pressure of 1.13 atmospheres, I think is what it is. But it's all computers, and the computers, your life support, and you've got three of them on you, all telling you what your oxygen is, your partial pressure of oxygen is, and if one of those goes bad, you go off the other two. If two of them go bad, you've got a whole backup setup. And these guys are wearing 150 pounds of gear when they're doing this, and then you would go to a mixed gas or a bailout situation, some form of nitrox probably, to get out of there, which could still take you 2 hours to get to the surface, depending on the depth that you're at. Yeah, depending on the depth that you're at, you are immediately going to, instead of diving off of a computer, you have to go to a Navy dive table for the depth that you're at. So you're going to pull that table out, you're going to read it, and you're going to understand it, and you're going to say, I've been down here for 35 minutes. I need to breathe this gas can for 30 minutes at this depth, and then I got to go up and breathe this bottle for 20 minutes at this depth, or whatever the protocol would be for based off of the dive profile, they would call it, that you were on. Yeah, pretty serious stuff. And people die. Can you say that again?
You talk about how doing this work as gaining new skills as a videographer opened up the world.
Sure. So how is this, having this job and the fact that I dive often while doing it, how has that changed my perspective of being a videographer? Yeah. I'm ADHD, you know. Probably a lot of you have kids that are like that, right? When I am diving and I have the camera on me, the symptoms of that completely disappear. And you are focused on your life support system that you're carrying that's keeping you alive, the air that you're breathing. You're focused on your depth, the time that you're down there, the amount of air you have left in your tank. You can kind of do all those three things at once, you know, a quick glance at a gauge. But then the rest of the time, I'm just totally in my element, focused on the shot, the shot, the shot. And the worries of the world go away. You're anxious when you get in the water. You know, you're suiting up, your heart rate's getting up because this gear's heavy, you got 60 pounds of equipment on you. My camera weighs 50 pounds out of water. It weighs a pound in the water. But, you know, you're lugging around all this stuff. It might be blowing wind out. It might be with high waves. You know, there might be marine mammals in the water. There might be obstructions. There might be all kinds of chaos going on underneath the surface. And certainly, if it's a wavy day, there's a lot of chaos on the top of the surface, on the surface as well. But once you're in that water and you get, you know, that first 10 breaths of air and you get to calm down and you turn your gear on, the camera on, and you head for that first bit that you're going to be filming, whether it's a coral reef or a reef fish or a shipwreck, you know, the world just suddenly becomes a very different, beautiful, serene place. And you're down there for as long as you can make that tank last, or as long as you still have 500 pounds of air in your tank when you come up, or the government's going to be very mad at you. But I mean, you're in an aquarium. You're in the world's largest aquarium when you're in the ocean. It's a beautiful thing, and every time is different. I've dove in a volcano in Hawaii. I've dove with the sea lions on Olympic Coast. Seen some pretty amazing reefs in the Florida Keys, which I can't compare them to what they were in the 60s, but they look pretty good to me when I was there. I would still say my favorite thing is descending from a boat on Lake Huron and watching that dark shadow become more and more into focus as the definition of a shipwreck that's been sitting on the bottom for 150 years comes into view. That, to me, is the best job in the world. So I love interacting with people. I love to hear people's stories and to interview them and get those details of who they are. And fortunately, because of the nature of my job, to get the full detail of that story will frequently take me below the surface. And that's just a humbling honor that I get to do that, you know, in service to the people of the United States. So, yeah. So I know a lot of you have come, Jenny. So people were, she just asked where you find our weekly videos. So how many people here are Facebookers? You're all Facebookers, right? Well, if you go to sanctuaries.noaa.gov, which is this site right here, / Earth is Blue, or if you just start at sanctuaries.noaa.gov, that will be your springboard to go to all this stuff. You don't need to go to social media to see it. Sometimes they stream a little better on social media than they do through the government site because we're limited in the formats we're able to upload. And they're not always user-friendly. But yeah, and I'm happy to give anyone my business card, which has that web address on it too. So that's a photo a day and a video a week. So now I want to bring you to the reason I think a lot of you are here, which is the story of the USS Conestoga. So I was actually in Alpena, Michigan, when I got a call saying, I need you to go to San Francisco. My boss calls me and says, I need you to go to San Francisco. There's something going on over there. And one of the divisions in our office is the Maritime History Division. And that is run by a gentleman who's kind of famous. His name is James Delgado. Anybody know Jim Delgado? Heard that name? Jim Delgado, he's been on, you know, History Channel, Discovery Channel. Yeah. He's down the hall from me, and I get to talk with Jim a lot, which is kind of funny because I heard stories about him before I worked there, and suddenly I realized I work in an office with Jim Delgado. And he's a guy with a big personality. He's an amazing storyteller. Anytime you sit down with this guy, he pretty much bogarts our weekly office meetings. Because everybody's like, yeah, I did this week. And he's like, well, there were men on a boat in a dark, stormy night. And suddenly, the waves came crashing against the hull, and these heroes went down to their ship. Only he'll do that for 20 minutes. And everybody's just raptured while this guy's talking. And then his face turns red, and he realizes he just took over the whole conversation. But it's really an honor to work with folks like that. Just a wealth of information of anything maritime history oriented. And he travels all over the world for this stuff. So he and a guy by the name of Robert Schwemmer, was once upon a time arrested for stealing things off of a wreck, although he worked out a deal, and then suddenly the government gave him a job because we realized he knew more than we did. He basically just keeps this running list of potential shipwreck sites and sites of interest in the Channel Islands and California part of the sanctuary system. And in 2009, NOAA had done a sonar survey of the Greater Farallones, at the time the Gulf of the Farallones National Marine Sanctuary, which is from just south of the gate in San Francisco. And I'm not sure how many miles north, but now it goes up Mendocino. It's big. Anyway, it's big. And they were looking at this survey, and actually a volunteer, a member of the public, was looking at this survey, which is often what happens because we can't possibly go through all the data we collect. And this guy by the name of Gary Fabian goes through the results of the survey, and then he says, you know, that, well, that looks like that could be a shipwreck, or that site over there, that looks like that could be a shipwreck. And then he calls up Bob, Robert Schwimmer, Shipwreck Bob, we call him, calls up Bob and says, Bob, I think that there's a shipwreck here, here, and here. And so then once we get a budget to do it, the office is sent out to go to those sites that Gary has told us about or that others have told us about, and we decide we're going to figure out what that anomaly is on that sonar scan. So they were going out to look for a few specific things that they think that they knew what they were, but there were a couple of things that they weren't so sure they knew what they were. And in fact, some of them shouldn't have even been there. So this is the story of the USS Conestoga. And the film will sort of explain itself, but I was sent out there to cover this expedition while it was happening in, I guess it was August or September of 2014. I realize the audio and the video is not quite synced up on this, and it's giving me a little bit of a headache, and I apologize for that. There's really nothing I can do about it, so bear with me. But this is the story of the discovery of the USS Conestoga in the Greater Fairlawn National Marine Sanctuary.
The Pacific Ocean, a mesmerizing dance of beauty, power, and unspeakable terror. Within it, many mysteries of the sea lie in wait. Some of these mysteries are surrounded by tales of harrowing glory or defeat, like the tale of the USS Conestoga. One of the top 10 unsolved maritime disasters of our age, when she left San Francisco, the Navy tug was bound for American Samoa via Pearl Harbor. Not long after leaving port, the USS Conestoga would vanish, leaving scant evidence of the events that befell her and her crew. An exhaustive search by the Navy, deploying every available vessel and aircraft, would rescue no souls, locate not a ship, and leave so many questions unanswered. For nearly a century, this mystery has remained unsolved. The loss of the vessel and her crew has left holes in the hearts of families, puzzled maritime historians, and inspired the public's imagination to wonder whatever happened to the USS Conestoga. NOAA's Office of National Marine Sanctuaries may have solved the Conestoga riddle. 2,000 miles from where the tug was suspected to have gone lost, an unexpected discovery in Greater Farallon's National Marine Sanctuary is revealing clues as to the fate of the missing naval vessel. With new hope in solving this mystery, the closure sought for so long by the families of the loved and lost might finally be within reach. In 1904, the Maryland Steel Company in Baltimore, Maryland, completed construction on a ship that was likely destined to have an unremarkable career by maritime standards. Like most vessels of similar construction, the seagoing tug was the often overlooked workhorse of seaports and navies. At 170 feet in length, constructed as a supply mover for the Philadelphia and Reading Railroad, Conestoga served her initial owners well before being purchased by the Navy in 1917. It was then that she was refitted for minesweeping and fleet tending in service to her country at the latter part of the First World War. From this point on, her fate would be intertwined with that of her crew, a collection of men from across America, several of whom had never seen a day on the water before meeting her deck with their feet. They were young men like Seaman Second Class Charles Joseph Ballant from Passaic, New Jersey, who was only 16 when he enlisted in the Navy, or boatswain Harvey Herbert Reinbold of Bethlehem, Pennsylvania, a brother to at least six siblings. And you would also find Mess Attendant First Class Edward Wilson, one of the first African-Americans to be allowed to serve on an American naval vessel. They would be led by Ernest Larkin Jones of Walnut Grove, Kansas.
He has to take this older fleet tug and take it across the Pacific dropping off a few men at Pearl Harbor, and then to proceed to American Samoa, where she's going to become a station ship. An important job, basically the floating representation of the United States Navy in those waters.
Jones would sail the Conestoga from Norfolk, Virginia, to Mare Island, where she would undergo final preparations and repairs. And on March 25th, 1921, she would push off toward Pearl Harbor. By mid-afternoon, she would clear the rocky entrance of the San Francisco Bay, likely with a barge in tow, and head out into the open waters of the Pacific. Steaming toward the horizon and out of sight of land, the ship and all her crew were never seen or heard from again.
Bob Schwimmer has a list, about as long as this arm, of sonar targets from a variety of surveys. In particular, we were working with a 2009 survey. It had a series of targets, some of which looked like they might be shipwrecks. We decided we'd go check those out.
One of the targets of interest was certainly a shipwreck, as it was revealed with the multi-beam survey. We had no historic record of a shipwreck of 170 feet in length, so we were very curious to investigate this site.
One of the most important parts of doing the work that we do in NOAA's Office of National Marine Sanctuaries is better understanding what's in those sanctuaries. Of course, when they're designated and created, you do research. You know, for example, with Farallones, that there's close to 400 shipwrecks out there. But knowing that they exist on a list or in a newspaper story dating back 100 years is very different than actually going out there and seeing, yes, there is a wreck, this is what's left of it, this is what it can tell us if we do archaeology, and this is how it has interacted with the marine environment and in some cases has become habitat.
But this is exciting to actually find a vessel, be able to identify the rig or the service of this vessel, and then do our detective work to try to piece together the puzzle and give her a name and tell her story.
There's still a sense of excitement, a little bit of impatience when you drop that robot in the water and it starts making its way down. Working on shallower sites means you can get there faster. When, in the case of the work in the Farallones, it's a matter of minutes. You're always watching, waiting, hoping that you can find the target that shows up on your sonar, and then suddenly there it is. Sometimes out of the darkness and the murk it appears. Sometimes you drop down and suddenly you are right there. There's a moment where you just go for a second and then you're keenly focused. You want to see exactly what it is. You're trying to soak up as much as you can, making observations, trying very hard not to blurt out, it's a this, it's a that.
First, that's what I was thinking.
Realizing that in many cases, yours are the first eyes, since some of these things went down, to ever see them.
Our first dive on the site, we came up on the starboard side of the bow of the shipwreck, and it had a very distinct straight stem. My colleague, Dr. James Delgado, recognized the ship as a tugboat.
Of course, Bob was like, are you sure? Well, let's start looking. If it is, there are going to be other things that we'll find.
That's the top of the engine. Ambient.
Oh yeah.
Cylinder head. See. Mm-hmm. But what we're going to want to be looking for down below is traces of boilers as we start to move. We should be seeing at some stage a boiler and a steam chest. Like any time.
We're going to take a look today at the steam tug Hercules, which we think is pretty close to the tugboat that we just saw sitting down on the bottom off the gate during our Maritime Heritage Cruise. We're going to try to match up features from the wreck to the historic tugboat, because I suspect they date to about the same time period, and that'll be an important clue in trying to identify the tugboat wreck, but it also gives us an opportunity when we do some outreach and education to say, this thing on the bottom once looked like this. Let's go.
What's missing on the vessel we've got on the bottom is all the superstructure, which in the tug on that we've got out there that's wrecked, this would all have been wood as opposed to this. On the other side of this bulkhead would be the engine, just as our engine is. When we were on the wreck and the ROV came in, we flew past the tow winch and we came right over and we stopped and we hovered right here and we were looking straight down on the top of the engine of the wreck. And the shape of the engine is the same, as you can see. The cylinder placement is about the same. My guess is, you know, being refreshed with Hercules, that we probably have a triple expansion.
So in comparison, this actually, seeing this vessel above water, it gives you a context of size. Because underwater, you're only looking at one portion of the ship at a time.
The more we looked at Hercules, I felt Bob, I, everybody, began to better understand and began to reconstruct in our mind's eye the tug we saw on the bottom from a wreck covered with marine growth into the tugboat it once had been. So our mission ended, and Bob and I had to pack up and quickly fly across the country to a Maritime Heritage Conference, which happens every few years. It was in Norfolk, Virginia. There were tables, displays. One of them was the Navy's Fleet Tug Association. And as I stood there and looked at things, there was a model of a fleet tug. And I thought more and more, as Bob and I had discussed, maybe it's a military tug.
Ironically, the room that I stayed in overlooked the Norfolk Navy Yard. And I recall seeing tugs moving in and out, towing barges through the harbor there.
So the more I looked at this model, I said, it's gotta be a military tug.
So I started working through the newspaper accounts of missing tugboats off San Francisco.
And then my phone rang, and it was Bob who said, can you come up to my room?
And I was struck by this article out of the San Diego Union, 1921, about a tugboat, a military tugboat, USS Conestoga.
So he had brought the discs, the hard drives, with all the video footage, and he was going through it bit by bit. And as he did, he spotted something. So when I came in, he said, what does that look like to you?
We had a historic image of the gunnery crew next to the 3-inch 50 caliber gun, very close up with the two sighting scopes, and continued reviewing the video. And as we got closer, there was the 3-inch 50 caliber gun. We certainly had a military tug, and it matched up perfectly with the image that we had from 1921.
No matter Conestoga's historic significance, whether it captured a headline or not, or what it did during the war, when that ship went missing, what made it important is that there were 56 guys on board who had families, people who cared about them, who wondered what had happened, and who never had an answer. As it became clear to us that this wreck was Conestoga, perhaps now, for their families, knowing where they were, this could provide closure.
Jim, please. It's so nice to meet you.
Diane.
Nice to meet you.
Thank you.
My pleasure. And this is Pam.
Hi, Pam.
Hi, Diane. Nice to meet you.
Same here.
And that's David.
Hi, David. I have a son named David. I won't forget that.
Yes, stories go back to my earliest recollections. That's the only one I have. You have to pick that one up to see it. The only one I have of him holding my mother.
Oh.
So Aunt May made a christening dress, and I have it in my mother's handwriting that my mother wore it in that picture, and then she passed the same handmade christening dress down, which my two children wore. So life goes on and there are traditions, and unfortunately a loss cuts so many of those.
What I think happened is that they left the Golden Gate, they sailed into a storm. The winds were building to gale force. They had 30 to 40 knot winds. So the sea is building up. The wire on her towing machine, or her winch, is somewhat loose. It's not neatly wrapped, which suggests that if they were towing, they lost it, and they're starting to take on water. And at a certain stage, the engineers probably called up to him and said, "We're in danger of sinking." And with that, then he has to make a decision.
He probably figured they couldn't make it all the way back into the gate and into San Francisco Bay without going down. But close by, probably, are the Farallon Islands. And at that time, there's a Navy radio station there, and there's a lighthouse there. But it was the only chance they had. The tug is pointed directly at the island, almost directly at the lighthouse. Mm. And as if they just kept going, and they're making for it. And the sad reality is they were only, they're just a little better than 3 miles away when it looks like they lost the fight. And the sea just was too powerful.
My mother always thought he was a hero. That was just a void in our family. And for my mother, a bigger void without her father. But I'm so thankful that it was found, that it can answer the biggest question our family has ever had. The fact that it's in a marine sanctuary seems more fitting. It's just natural. And that I know it won't be disturbed.
Thank you so much.
We'll see you soon.
Thank you.
Bye bye.
Yes,
on
the
23rd. Yes, ma'am.
Bye bye.
Given this great responsibility to share this story with the family members, and the, you know, the American public.
So this is my great uncle, Edward Wilson, who was my grandmother's brother.
Because it is a great story. You know, these guys are the heroes. They went down with their ship while in service of the U.S. Navy.
Well, it was more of an opening than a closure because I found out about my great-great-grandfather.
Well, the ringing of the bells 56 times was quite spiritual and so fitting as a dedication at the end of this beautiful day.
You read something in a history book, you dive on a wreck, and there are certain emotions that go with that. But nothing compares to finding something like Conestoga. It's history as it should be. It's about individuals, it's about families, it's not big names, it's not headlines. It's people who, in this case, grew up hearing stories of a grandfather who just simply didn't come home one day. It's all about people, and it's how we can connect with people and why we are, ultimately, no matter what branch we serve in, we are a government of the people, by the people, and for the people.
I was just a kid on a ship in the Navy in World War II, and we went to Pearl, and we went over this same area in a storm similar to what they're describing here in this movie. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you for your service. In that era, they really didn't have good weather reporting going on. So when these guys left around 3 o'clock in the afternoon, they really had no idea what was waiting for them. And, well, things happen. Yes, sir.
At what depth is the vessel now?
I think it's about 190 feet. So, if one were of a mind to, you could dive it if you wanted to. Although it's not recommended, the area is known for great whites. Great white sharks. There's a lot of shark research that happens at those islands out there, actually. That's another thing I've done is film great whites out at those Farallon Islands where they were 3 miles from. I was in an 18-foot boat and a 17-foot great white came up to us. Yeah. No, but everybody I've told that story to says that.
Do I just hold it?
So the tug, the Conestoga was, it moved from Norfolk. They did repairs to it and retrofit it for minesweeping and fleet tending in Norfolk. And then it was ordered to go to American Samoa. So to get to American Samoa, it made its way through the canal, then up the west coast. It was then worked on one last time at Mare Island, which is in the backwaters of San Francisco Bay, and then set sail from there. So then it had, I think 40-some guys were going to end up at American Samoa, and so about 10 guys were going to be dropped off at Pearl Harbor. It would refuel at Pearl Harbor, and then it would head down to American Samoa from there. So actually, when they started searching for this thing, they were searching around the Hawaiian Islands. And up until Amelia Earhart went missing, there was never a search of this size. Every available vessel and aircraft was the order. And that included submarines, that included planes, that included cruisers, whatever was available. And actually, there's a lot of side stories to this as well. Actually, a submarine ran out of fuel, and the captain of the submarine ordered the guys to tie their bed sheets together, and they made a sail out of everyone's bed sheets to try and sail back to Pearl Harbor. Mm. Yeah.
Sir?
Yes?
You know, when you find these ships, do they try to bring them up, or they just leave them there, or maybe bring something up to show that it was that ship?
Yeah. So the question, well, everybody heard the question. It's going to be pretty rare that we would bring something up. We're certainly not going to try and raise the ship, at least during my tenure, and that's certainly not a decision I'm involved with. We've never raised anything. Now, there may be an artifact that's of significance that, you know, with the example of the Edmund Fitzgerald, they took the bell off and replaced it with a dedication bell with the names of everyone on board, and they put that back on the ship. We haven't done anything like that. Typically, what's that? In the Conestoga? So that's all an ROV. So they're controlling a remotely operated, like a robot that swims through the water, that's attached by an umbilical to the ship, and because. Again, and actually, if you watch all of the footage, at one point the ROV is swimming along and it just kind of gets pushed down really quickly. And we're pretty sure that was a shark that was bumping into this thing and just testing it out. We want to catalog what's there. We want to understand what's there and keep a record of it. And so if we go back in 10 years, we can analyze and compare what it looked like in 2014 to say, you know, 2024 or something like that. So we'll understand how the habitat is changing, We'll know from the detailed drawings and imagery what, you know, the deterioration of the ship, just with the elements. Are there any new species that are living on the wreck? We want to make sure that it isn't, you know, one of the problems you run into is these trawlers drag these huge anchors and things along the bottom. So, like, none of the superstructure of the tug exists anymore. And part of that is just the years of being in the bottom of the ocean, but there's also anchors and things get dragged along the bottom and they rip things off from time to time. So, the salt water has the exact opposite effect, actually. And there's worms, so anything that was wood, the deck would have been wood. Worms would have eaten the deck. Ships don't do real well in salt water. In fact, like the Titanic is about to totally collapse on itself. And a lot of these wrecks that divers have been diving for years are becoming very, very hazardous because of what salt water does to wrecks. On the other hand, in the Great Lakes, it acts like a refrigerator, and you find wrecks at 190 feet with their masts still standing. And if you're a technical diver, you're doing a decompression stop at a crow's nest, and that mast is still standing. And there'll even be lines, you know, dangling off of them and floating off into the water. So, yeah. Yes, sir.
One more question. One of the images was of parallel lines that a scan from underwater radar or sonar. What gives those parallel lines?
The thing that was scanning?
No, you could see it. It looked like a whole row of fish steps side by side. It was scans of some kind.
Yeah. The rainbow colored image. Yeah. So it's bottom sand scan sonar.
Okay.
So like, you might see it in stripes because you know the chip will go this way,
okay,
turn around and then go this way. And scan the bottom, and then they overlay the different. But then there's another shot of like a sonar scanning while the ROV is in the water, and the ROV has a sonar on it, and so they're reading that screen, and they can tell, like, you know, are we coming up on something, which is, I think, a little different. But any other questions? Yes, sir. Yeah, I'm not an expert on that. I know Dr. Delgado has dove on that, and that's one of the wrecks that you have to have a permit, I think, from the Park Service to dive on. And they dive on it basically to check the integrity of the hull, and occasionally a reef will be laid, or sometimes some of the surviving crew, when they pass away, ask for their ashes to be put in the ship. I know it's slowly deteriorating, and it will eventually not be there anymore.
Well, the Titanic though is so far down, so deep, but didn't they have like a little machine
Yeah, there's manned submersibles, is the question. Like, do people go down to these wrecks? Like, you can take a manned submersible down to these wrecks. We didn't do that in this case. It wasn't in the budget, and it wasn't really necessary to do that. Well, of course, it's expensive. Yeah. Sometimes we'll partner with people that have an ROV, or an outfit that's good at raising grants or something. And they've got their ROV, or, you know, they pay for it any number of ways, or it could just be a wealthy individual that likes to have their own ROV. We'll partner with these people sometimes.
What's an ROV?
An ROV is a remotely operated vehicle. So that's different than a manned submersible, which is, you know, people actually at the controls. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. But they've been able to go inside the Titanic with very small remotely operated vehicles that are smaller than a vehicle that a person could drive to, like, go through, like, a window in a bedroom and, you know, slowly swim around inside, you know, and then, yeah, that's, you know, yeah, it's risky, too, because you're connected to the surface, and or you could be connected to a manned submersible. But, you know, that umbilical can get tangled up on stuff. So you always have to be aware of the structure of the ship and the surrounding environment, because if you could get all turned around and tie that thing into a knot, and then you just lost your $10,000, $20,000, $100,000 remotely operated vehicle. And your life. Yeah, possibly your life. Well, you know, and if you lose the $10,000 ROV, you might lose your life later. Yeah. So we've been here about an hour and 40 minutes. Unless there's any other pressing questions, I just want to thank again the museum for having me out here. I hope that I was able to introduce you to the National Marine Sanctuaries for those of you that weren't familiar with it. Thank you. I want to thank all the veterans that came out. It's a real honor to have you be part of this audience. And keep up the good work to the museum. Thanks again, and happy to answer any questions at the door, et cetera. Thank you.
And before you go, David, we'd just like to present you with this USS Silverside Submarine Museum hoodie.
There it is.
That's right. That's why he came out here. Thank you very much. Appreciate it.